Brazil is the largest country in South America. When we think of Brazil, we think of the beautiful city of Rio de Janeiro. We think of the waterfalls of Iguazu with all their splendor. Or we think about football and famous football players. But we don't think about leprosy. Yet until 2005, Brazil had the highest prevalence of leprosy in the world and still registers 40,000 new cases every year. Within Brazil, for 60 years, the ACRE state had the highest incidence of leprosy. For decades, people who feared they might have the disease hid away and came forward only when it was too late to help them. Such was the case of this pretty 16-year-old called Dora. When she discovered she had leprosy, she hid away in the jungle and didn't come back to town until 20 years later, when her hands had been crippled and her feet destroyed. But today, that has all changed. People come with just a small skin patch that can be cured. When skin examinations for early diagnosis of leprosy are announced, everybody comes. Until recently, 110 out of every 10,000 inhabitants of the state of Acre had leprosy. That has now dropped to below 2 in 10,000. And the strange thing is that this dramatic change was brought about by a boy from Belfast, who was one of the worst students who ever attended Belfast High School. His average mark in Latin was 7%. Yet, in the Ministry of Health in Brasilia, Brazil's capital city, there's a portrait gallery of all the leading Brazilian surgeons and scientists. And among those illustrious portraits is one of that boy. I call to the platform Dr. William Woods. Dr. William, this tribute comes from the people of this state. We all love you. He's an honored member of the ACRE Academy of Medicine. He was twice honored by the Brazilian Minister of Health, and he received an OBE from Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth in recognition of his sterling work.
I have been 50 years now in the Amazon rainforest, and as we think together of all that the Lord has done in spite of me, I ask you with me to magnify the Lord and let us exalt His name together.
I was born on the 5th of October 1937 at 50 Ranley Street in Belfast. When I was barely 2 years old, the Second World War began. My father was an Ulster volunteer. He was not conscripted. His ship, the Empire Hope, was one of the first ships in the Malta convoy to be destroyed by enemy planes overhead. As it sank, the order was given to abandon ship. But he and another man remained on board until the waters of the Mediterranean put their guns out of action. This brought an invitation for the family to Buckingham Palace, where he was decorated by the late King George. In the meantime, my mother rented part of the schoolhouse in Ballygowan, where we spent the war years. As the war drew to an end, the family moved back to live on the Ravenhill Road, where I attended as a child the Ravenhill Free Evangelical Church. But it wasn't until I joined the 30th BB Company attached to Orangeville Presbyterian Church that I first came really to understand the gospel. Sunday school teachers and BB officers took me to a gospel meeting in McQuiston Presbyterian Church conducted by Oswald Smith from Canada. It was there I indicated at first my desire to become a Christian. But because I was 12, I was given a little decision card to sign. However, I soon started attending again the Ravenhill Free Presbyterian Church. An enthusiastic young preacher was beginning his long career. And it was there on the 5th of July, 1952, that I accepted the Lord as my Savior.
Whether you be religious or irreligious.
When the new church was opened in White Abbey in January of 1953, I was there. And in White Abbey, I would preach my first sermon. Another teenager led the meeting that night. His name was John Douglas. I would later work again in White Abbey with the late Cecil Harvey from Crossgar. At a missionary meeting in the Martyrs where Mrs. Eads from the Cape Verde Islands was speaking, I first felt the Lord was calling me to full-time service. Mrs. Eads was better known as Jessie Munn, and the Munn family, especially Emma, when she came from Africa, would have a great impression on my life. Some of us from the Martyrs formed the Victory Testimony Band. We cleaned out a barn in Macrosgues where we held a gospel mission. Many people were saved who are still in the Lord's work today. Mr. Jim Douglas from Newton Ayres Baptist, a young girl called Betty, today a member of the Martyrs Memorial with her husband. Dr. Paisley would later go there for a gospel campaign, but he only stayed a week and I had to carry on. Followed up by Reverend David McElveen, another mission, and out of that small beginning, the Ballygowan Free Presbyterian Church was formed. In 1954, I got to know outgoing missionaries to Brazil, Fred and Dinah Orr.
1937, that the Lord opened the door for us to go to ACRE. In company with Miss Molly Harvey, we landed in Rio Branco.
Fred and Dinah were going to Brazil with the ACRE Gospel Mission. They were sent out by Castlereagh Baptist Church. At their final meeting there, Ina sang that beautiful hymn, "Let Me Burn Out for Thee." The next night, there would be a large crowd at the boat to wave the couple goodbye. They would travel to Liverpool, where they'd take a Boothline steamer that would take them 1,000 miles up the Amazon. They traveled on the Hillary. After a few days in Manaus, they would then travel for 1,700 miles on the River Purus, the longest tributary of the Amazon. It would be a long, slow journey on a paddle steamer. It would take them at least 3 weeks and perhaps more. The steamer would stop from time to time to take on wood to burn in its engines and keep the paddles turning. After some days, they would have to change to a smaller steamer as the river got narrower and drier. After 8 days on the Sunday evening, Ina said, "I've got fever." There was nothing they could do. They couldn't turn back. The steamer just went on and on and on. There was no one could speak English. They couldn't speak Portuguese. And every day, Ina seemed to get worse. At the side of the river, there was just a few houses. But then on the Friday evening at 4 o'clock, Ina became delirious. 6 o'clock, she went unconscious. And 8 o'clock in the evening, she went to be with the Lord. The first missionary to arrive in Labria was not to preach the gospel, but he wasn't welcome even so. He had come to bury his wife.
Tell the story, save my
grace. Fred would return to Labria after he had learned the language, and he stayed there for some 17 years. Today there's a very strong church. It supports their own pastor and has sent out and support missionaries to other parts of that river. They even have a seminary where they prepare students for full-time service. The church has just recently bought its own boat to take the gospel to the people on the rivers. Fred would move to Manaus after 17 years, where he started another church and where he started another seminary. He later married and today is surrounded by his wife and family. But when the news of Ina's death came to Ireland, it came as a great challenge to many young people. And I felt God was saying I sought for a man to stand in the gap. Following Dr. Paisley's advice, I began my training for full-time service at the Missionary Training College of the Weck Mission in Scotland. 2 full years and difficult years because I was always sick. Finally, a few weeks after my 21st birthday, I was accepted for work with the ACRE Gospel Mission. However, I would stay in Northern Ireland for another year. We had gospel missions in conjunction with the Faith Mission in Northampton, very near the old Cabra Church, and in the Craigs Mission Hall, and in Maboy Mission Hall. Again, many people were saved at those missions. Some today are still in the Lord's work, like George Wright from Cullybeck. Finally, in 1960, in August, I was ready to sail for Brazil. Again, there would be a large crowd of friends gathered at the boat to bid me goodbye. And I would travel to Brazil on the Boothline ship, the Hubert, which would take me 1,000 miles up the Amazon. I spent 3 months living with the missionaries in Labrie, where I studied the language, Portuguese. My first Christmas away from home ever, I spent in the Boca do Acre with the late Miss Molly Harvey. And finally, in 1961, I moved to Kanatama. Kanatama was just one street along the edge of the river. It was a very small and backward town, and then one street penetrating into the forest from the edge of the river. Our house was one of the best houses in town. We had a modern kitchen and a modern kitchen unit, sink unit here. Because we had no ceilings, we just had to be accustomed to the rats on the headboard of your bed at night. But you got used to it after a while. My first task in Kanatama was to help in the building of the church. The wood was taken from the forest, sawed, planed, and put in place. It was a great day when the church was finally completed. But we were there to build up the living church. And after some years, the Lord gave an abundant harvest in that little town. The old wooden church has now been replaced by a permanent brick building. My first year in Kanatama, I lived with Jack and Joan Maudsley. Joan was a nurse. And when she left on furlough, people still came to the house looking for help. I was called to see a boy bitten by a snake.
Where is the nurse?
She is on holiday. She's not here.
My family spent 6 days rowing a canoe to get here, with me under a plastic cover, and she is not here.
But I'm going to send you to Manas. In Manas, there's a hospital and doctors and nurses, and they will take care of you.
Como vai me mandar?
Why are you going to send me? If there's a boat leaving today, it would take 10 days to get there.
I'm going to send you on the plane. It comes once a week.
What day does the plane come?
On Thursdays.
What day is today?
It was hard to tell him that it was Friday. I told him I would pray for him.
I don't want you to pray for me. I want you to do something to help me, to ease my pain, to save my life.
He died on Sunday morning, a little graveyard in the forest just outside Kanatama. It's a simple cross that says, I don't know not, but to me it used to say, do something, do something. A few days later, a neighbor sent me some fish.
Donna Marie sent this for you.
Oh, it's fish. I must have done. It's very hot.
It doesn't matter. It never hurts when I burn my hand.
Come into the house and let me see your hands.
Yes, his hands were indeed burnt. How could a little boy burn his hands and not feel pain? I got out Mrs. Maudsley's books and I discovered, yes, that little boy had leprosy and nothing was being done to help him. And then I discovered in almost every house in that little town, someone had leprosy and was hidden away. But what could I do? God would fit me for the job he was calling me to do. Not far from Kanatama is the mouth of the Mokoween River, and in the Mokoween there's another tributary, the Forbidden River. It was on this river that lived the very, very hostile Juma Indians. No one ever entered into their village and came out alive. Many of their victims were found without heads. We thought they were headhunters. But God sent wonderful American missionaries with a vision to reach the Juma Indians for Christ, no matter what it cost. They would travel up the Forbidden River, and at the side of the river there, near the Juma territory, they would construct a little house where they would live, sometimes even with their family. In order to travel from Kanatama to the Juma River, the late James Gunning would give Arne his boat, the Good News, to facilitate that travel. From time to time, I would go with Arne into the villages. We never saw the Indians, but they saw us. Sometimes it took us 3 days to go there and get back again. We took Etead, an Indian from another tribe, hoping that she would tell the Indians we wanted to be their friend. But before she could get the message over, they came out and killed her. The final break after 6 years, when Arne met two of the Indians on the trail. Some months later, in 1966, I would be with Arne when we arrived at the village, 6 in the evening. We could hear the Indians talking. We waited until dawn, but when we went into the villages, the Indians had gone. While we waited, a spotted leopard came walking up just a few feet away from us. Eventually, the Indian chief and his wife arrived, and we'd made the first contact in their villages with these savage Indians. Arn kept up that contact, and eventually was able to take his wife and family, his daughter Terry here, with the Indian woman whom I met on that particular day. Finally, a peaceful contact had been made with the Juma Indians. That little woman, so sweet, was later buried alive because nobody had ever told her that Jesus saves. When the contact was peacefully made, the British Indian government moved the Juma Indians to another area, and the Abraham sons moved to work with the Brazilian people. Arn went to be with the Lord in 2005, but today his wife, Joyce, continues, even in her 80s, running a Christian school for poor children, hoping to win them for the Savior. My last year was spent in the Boca do Acre. At the end of that year, 1967, I felt the time had come to move and prepare myself. I prepared a letter for the mission.
My mother sent me to tell you that Sebastiana can't go back to school because her foot is bleeding a lot.
That family lived on the other side of the river. Several had leprosy. Milton hid in fear, hardly showing his face at the window. Sebastiana was a lovely girl, but terribly deformed feet, and nothing was being done. I asked, did the mother want medicines?
No, she doesn't want anything. She said you needed to know that my sister is getting worse and no one does anything to help.
I took my letter to the post office, and when I was leaving, the postmistress gave me one that she'd forgotten, a letter she'd forgotten to give me. When I opened it, I read these words, "Where God's finger points, there God's hand will make the way." In 1968, in January, I moved to Manaus, where I made my inscription to take entrance exams to the Federal University. I was competing against hundreds of young Brazilians just out of pre-medical school, taking those exams in their own language, chemistry, physics, Portuguese language and literature. I was always a terrible student at Belfast High School. I seldom passed a chemistry exam, and I failed those exams. And what now? Manaus is a fastly growing city. My monthly allowance from the mission has been cut off. I have no money. What am I going to do? But God's hand made the way. Those exams were repeated only once in the history of any university in Brazil. And in the second round of examinations, I passed. I would often visit the old leprosy hospital just outside Manaus. I would see a patient like Alberto. No legs, no hands, and no eyes, but still able to sing God's praise. Oh, if there'd only been an eye specialist, a doctor there to save just a flicker of light in one of those eyes. Yes, I would take the dressing off an elderly lady, a sweet Christian lady, but the intraocular pressure had been so high in her only eye that it perforated. There was nothing there. "Why can't I see?" she would ask. As I put the dressing back, there was nothing could be done. At that time, Brazil had 360,000 people with leprosy. And I only knew of one eye specialist who attended one afternoon each week. After graduation, I moved to Rio de Janeiro. I studied ophthalmology in Rio de Janeiro in the Royal Victoria Hospital, and again in the Royal Victoria in Dublin. Then I spent some months in India where Dr. Paul Brand and especially his wife Margaret, who was an ophthalmologist, was a great help. In 1979, I returned to the ACRE state where I would lead the government's leprosy elimination program for over 30 years. The ACRE state covered by a dense jungle with 700,000 inhabitants. The riverways are still our roadways. The capital, Rio Branco, is a fast-growing city and a modern city. The governor's palace was built at the time of the great rubber boom. Rio Branco is built on the river Acre. In the dry season, it dries up, but in the wet season, it will fill up again. And it very often will even overflow its banks. It was in the central hospital in Rio Branco that we set up our clinics to begin to attend the patients in the city of Rio Branco and also to to reach out all across the state. Initially, we had help from Miss Emily Gilchrist from Castle Derg. Emily would teach a young auxiliary nurse pastor how to apply the new medicines for leprosy. 30 years later, that young lady is still working with us. Christian nurse Ruth also worked very closely with Emily. And again, 32 years later, Ruth is still there in the program. A skin specialist called Dr. Leia, and indeed all the team that began with us 30 years ago are still working there in the program to eliminate leprosy from the state. After many years, we began to see people cured of that disease. A young man with advanced leprosy. And then 25 years after being discharged as cured, he still remains without a mark. Leprosy was reduced, yes, 98%. But I also work with another disease called Lobo's disease. It's a fungus disease that grows on the arms in the tropical area. When removed by surgery, it comes back again. But we found out that using three special drugs together, when the disease was removed by surgery, and that's the same year, it didn't come back again. This lady had these lesions on her leg for over 30 years. When she took the medicine, they began to atrophiate. And today she can even wear a shoe. Unsightly lesions on the nose. Well, I burn these off every day in the hospital. Today we're working on a special research program with research scientists from São Paulo and from the University of Florida to prove that these three drugs that we've been using can cure this disease. Surgery is carried out every day, almost every day, to remove these lesions. And the quality of life improves for an elderly man, the same gentleman, with the lesions removed. But leprosy also affects the hands. And for a young boy, a thing like picking up a cup can be very difficult. He can't really use his thumb. Lucia was a dressmaker, but with paralyzed hands, she could no longer work, for she couldn't pick up a needle. And so she could no longer work. But over 30 years ago, surgery, two surgeries to each hand, changed her life. After the surgery was over, she could say, yes, I can pick up my needle again. I can sew. She was so happy. And now 30 years later on today, she's still sewing at her sewing machine. Leprosy can cause another condition called drop foot. The patient can't lift his foot when he tries. It simply turns inwards. This makes it difficult when he has to walk. And eventually the foot will really turn inwards and become deformed, and usually ends up being amputated. However, again, surgery can change all that condition. This man came into hospital, had the surgery. He had to learn how to walk after the surgery was over. But he came to know the Lord in the hospital, and 30 years later, he's still walking. It was in this hospital, too, that I set up my clinic to attend those who suffered from eye problems. And for over 30 years, the patients there had the very best of equipment to resolve their eye and ocular problems. We attended many hundreds of patients over the year, not only leprosy patients, but poor people who came in need of help. When you have anesthetic hands that don't feel, then surgery and eyesight is so important. And I had the opportunity of operating many, many people. Lino couldn't see, and he couldn't feel. And so even eating was a terrible problem. To find the spoon, and when he does find it, it's difficult even to pick up. How thankful we should be that we have hands that can pick up things and eyes that can see. Eventually he gets the spoon, but he doesn't really realize that there's a lot of food in the tray, and very often he'll only eat what he finds at the front. But again, surgery to remove the cataract with a high-powered microscope can bring about a radical change and move the quality of life for this man who's already suffered so much. Now he can see. It's easier to find the spoon. It's easier to pick it up. He'll even check the wheelchair and make sure it's all right. I was traveling through the United States on my way back to Brazil on one occasion, and I picked up a portable operating microscope contained in this suitcase. I would travel with it in small planes over the jungle to Tarawacá, Labre, Canatama, Cruzeiro do Sul, Porto Velho, Manaus, and even to West Africa. And it helped me to bring back vision to many, many, many people. One of the first surgeries that I did in the ACRE state was in Tarawacá. Dr. Tom Geddes was helping me. The patient was a 90-year-old lady.
We were just about finishing the surgery. I was helping Bill when the nurse said that Donna Anna's pressure had dropped and we noticed she had stopped breathing. It meant leaving the surgery to Bill alone and then trying to some cardiac external cardiac massage, and thankfully she began breathing and her heart beating again. It wasn't our only adventure with Bill in an operating theatre. He arrived at our door in Rio Branco once with the signs and symptoms of acute appendicitis. The only hospital I had the contact with was the maternity hospital, and when I spoke to the director, he kindly agreed to get out of his sick bed and give the anaesthetic. We removed Bill's appendix, and as he was recovering from the anaesthetic, the nurse told him it was all over. She then said, "It was a little boy. What are you going to call him?" Bill said, "Paisley." He then went on to ask me if I knew that Dr. Paisley was having his twins adopted. And I said, "No." He said, "It's because they won't take their orange juice. You can take a man out of Ulster, but you can't take Ulster out of a man."
You don't believe what he says about the Ulster man, but I hope you like my car, especially the number plate. Donna Anna survived that surgery, and so did I. Dr. Tom and his wife Lucy Marr carry on a very valuable work in the schools in Rio Branco today, where 2,000 children are taught each week the Word of God. I would often fly in those early days across the jungle. I'd look down on the forest from those little plains hour after hour. The rivers were still our roadways, but there in the heart of the jungle, I would see a little dot, a little house, and I would realize it was someone who had never heard the gospel and needed the medication for leprosy. I would go to every home where someone had that disease. Eventually, we'd put the canoe into the river. Donna Maria Jose will be gone now for 3 weeks. I would spend 6 weeks in this boat at a time, traveling right to the very headwaters of all the rivers in the ACRE state, day after day, and often week after week. 3 years I spent Christmas and New Year on those boats. We eat on the boat. We live on the boat. We sleep on the boat when nighttime comes. We put up our hammocks. And we spend the night there. But with the darkness also comes the mosquitoes in their hundreds. Yes, we're stuck. We're stuck on the rocks. So we all have to jump in the river and push. Everybody has to push. When you're stuck, it's the safest place to be is in the water. The boat eventually floated away. But one of the workers was left behind. I told him to hurry up because he wasn't alone in the river. But very often we would go there from that boat to visit the homes of the people. We leave behind in every home some copy of God's word, and they were never refused. When the river dries up, there's nothing to do but wade through the mud. How often I've had to do that myself. I used to sing some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, and I'm in the mud. Yes, we'd leave the boat and travel by canoe, and some journeys maybe for 6 days. the river can really flow very fastly, and it can become very dangerous when you're in a canoe if you're traveling. The River Tarawaka is a great river, a mighty river. You can see the volume of water here. But this is the same river where we go to at the headwaters. And I've been to the headwaters of every river that cuts across the ACRE state. The people in the canoe are there to get their medication. The man has leprosy. But the women in this picture, a few months later, were killed by Indians who came out of the forest and speared them to death. We eat in the canoe. And of course, it's a self-service restaurant. He uses his hands because his feet are occupied. But we can have a refreshing drink to wash it down. Sometimes we face dangers and difficulties to get through. The river can flow very fast. And then we can come across a problem like this. You need to watch your heads when you come to a place like this. When I shout, duck, everybody, duck! 3 times to reach the homes of patients I had to swim. And again, I'm reminded that you're not alone in those waters. My last journey on a horse was 3 days through the forest to attend patients. In the canoe, we'll do even biopsies and minor surgeries to help those who need them. And some of those riverbanks can be so hard and difficult to climb. And some of the bridges are not easy to get over. Wonder will I make it? It's quite a struggle to get me across. My last trip walking through the forest was just 2 years ago. I was in my 70s at the time. And my last river trip was last year in December of 2009. But I will make it across and back again on the return journey. It's tricky going, but we'll get there. But I wonder, will the nurse that works with me, will he make it? Oh, it's not easy. Yes, we walk through the forest, sometimes for hours on end. And it's not always plain going. Sometimes we're going downhill and coming uphill, and it can be so difficult.
Matt. I got a cigarette.
And when we walk through the forest, we encounter many difficulties. Not only the spotted leopard, a potential danger, a very highly poisonous snake, hard to be seen there in the middle of the ground, in the middle of the bushes and the leaves. Another bridge to get across, and finally we arrive at the patient's house. On this particular trip, it took 3 hours there and 3 hours back again to the edge of the river. We're glad to arrive. On this particular day, we had lunch of boiled monkey and mandioc root. And it's wonderful when you get back after a journey like this, even to the canoe, where you can stretch out and rest on your way back again to the boat. And after many hours, it's just amazing to get back to the old floating bathtub, but it's so home. It has been home now for 6 weeks. And we're glad to get back again into the boat. We do it because we come across people like this. This young man has leprosy. He lives away at the headwaters of one of those rivers. He needs the medication. You can see just one skin patch on his back here, but he has many other skin patches on his body. This man also lived on the same river. But he didn't have the medication, and he became deformed. But the former man that you saw there today is completely healed. There's not a mark on his body. 15,000 patients have been cured of leprosy since I went to the ACRE. Even Milton, who hid away in fear, was eventually cured. And hundreds like him. Doctors, nurses, politicians. My first journey on the River Tees was just about 25 years ago. It rained and rained every day. At night we'd look for a home at the side of the river, put up our hammocks and spend the night. But the rain continued day after day for 6 days. But in every home, we left behind some copy of God's precious word. Jonas was just a young boy when he was treated for leprosy and cured, but he read the gospel literature left and came to know the Lord. Several of his cousins also came to the Lord. And today there are many little congregations dotted along that river where the gospel is preached each week.
Today I live in a comfortable home here in Weyburn, but I still have some unpleasant visitors.
Tarantula spiders are a common thing in the house. And of course, the ants. My special thanks to all who have prayed and supported me over the years.
We do magnify the Lord. We magnify His grace in the life of Dr. Bill Woods. We thank Bill for this testimony and thank God for these 50 years of service to Him. Today in Brazil and in Europe, the work of ACRE International continues through national workers and foreign missionaries doing the work of the gospel. Magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt His name together. Yes, together. We need you in this work of the gospel, your prayers, your support, that the work of the gospel may continue in Brazil, in Portugal, and in Lanzarote today. Thank you and may God bless you. Amen.
The challenge remains. That little woman who was buried alive because she'd never heard that Jesus saves. But her grandchild will not have her fate. Living with Christian missionaries, we're praying she'll come to the Lord. As we fly over the forest of the Amazon Valley, and even in that state of ACRE, there are still perhaps 6 tribes of Indians who have never been reached with the gospel message or contact by the outside world. Some years ago in a terrible famine in the Sudan, a well-known photographer took this very dramatic picture, a dying child and a vulture waiting to devour its flesh. He won many prizes because of that picture. But then the questions began to come in. What happened to the child? Did it die? Did the vulture attack it? However, he couldn't answer. He had stood still for 20 minutes waiting for the vulture to land, and then he snapped his photograph and walked away. Jesus said to his disciples, "Will you also walk away?" God has promised, where his finger points, his hand will make the way. He may not remove the waterfall, but he'll give you the strength, as he's done for me and others on many occasions, to take the canoe out of the water and pull it up the bank and put it back in after the waterfall, and then go back for the motor.